So what we're going to do here is look at the behavior of sample proportions. And where it's going to start off is we're going to have some population proportion or some proportion that we expect to come through. And then we're going to look at is what happens when we take a certain sample size, given that we expect a certain proportion to come through. And what we want to end up with is, given that we pass certain conditions, is we want to end up with a nice bell-shaped curve. Because again, a bell-shaped curve, we can find probabilities with, we can do all sorts of things. So when we have skewed distributions that we get stuck. But we wanna look at this distribution for if I took all possible samples, I wanna see how sample proportions behave given a certain sample size. So in this video, it's gonna be similar to the sampling distribution of means video. We're just gonna look at a simulation so we can understand how the bell-shaped curve comes through, what's our mean, what's our standard deviation, and what are certain conditions that we have to be careful of. So in our example, we're gonna look at rolling a die 60 times and this kind of probability that a 1 shows up. So we're gonna have this sample size of 60 and the set proportion of 1/6 to represent the probability of rolling a 1. So we're gonna have this expected proportion of 0.1667. But if you could imagine, if I had you sit down and roll a die 60 times and tally up how many times you saw a 1, yeah, maybe you get exactly 10 times you see a 1, maybe you get 11, maybe you get 9. So while we expect this 1/6 proportion to come through, there can be a little bit of variability there. And that variability is what comes through in our distribution. It's that we expect to be at 1/6, but we can see results a little bit above, a little below, and as we get further away, it becomes less and less common to see those sample results. So let's move over to a simulation that I have set up, and we'll just talk about the different windows that we can see there. So our simulation's in StatKey for this video. It's gonna create a sampling distribution of proportions. I have it set up so you can see original population on this right-hand side. I need to edit so that it shows this proportion of 1/6 coming through. So original population, I have this set proportion of 0.1667. So when this operates, that's the expected outcome. Then I just need to edit my sample size, which is at 200 right now, to 60. Again, for these simulations, you will not need to do this yourself. It's just to show you where these distributions come from. So original population here is just stating our set population proportion. Oops. So with starting these questions, we're gonna have some population proportion, or rather some value for P. Then what we're gonna do is take a sample. So if I just generate one sample, what this is doing here is it's simulating 60 outcomes and saying we saw a result 11 times. So it's working with the idea that we expect 1/6 to come out, but like in this case, we ended up with a little bit more, which happens with a single sample. So this sample window is showing just one sample. So it simulates a sample of size 60 and shows how many successes. Or rather, it really shows p hat if you take those number of successes out of 60. In that last column there, they're showing our sample proportion. That 0.183 would be our p hat. And that's where if we go to the sampling dot plot of proportions, that 0.183, that's what's being plot right there on our graph. So it has this expected value, we take a sample operating with that kind of expected value, and then we take the actual sample proportion and plot it. Then I could do it again, and we got something a little bit different, but we got a second value. And then again, we could just do this on and on and on, but as we collect samples, the idea that most of our samples should be around here. They should be near that 0.1667, but like we see, we got a little bit lower, we got a little above. So when I go to generate 1,000 samples, there's a nice bell-shaped curve, which is exactly what we want, centered 0.168, which is very close to our 0.167. It's just a little off due to variability here with sampling. So the distribution of proportions, it's collected sample proportions. Or their p-hat values from a sample size of 60. Again, sample size is going to be important in terms of if it's a large sample or a small sample. All right, let's look at the statistics that we're seeing come through here. And really we want to focus on the statistics in this upper right-hand corner of our sampling dot plot of proportions. So it says samples, and that basically just tells us how many dots we have here. It's basically how many sample proportions we collected. Then there's a mean, and there's a standard error, which standard error for now is just the same thing as standard deviation. We'll talk about it a little bit more when we go into confidence intervals. But what it represents is the same as a standard deviation. So we have this mean and standard deviation. So the mean that we have there, it is a population mean, because if we're taking so many samples, we're getting at the idea of infinity, and what if we took all the samples we could possibly take? The mean is the average of those sample proportions. So where we have all of those p-hat values, this is an average of those p-hat values. And notation-wise, what we use is we use mu for a population mean. Then what we're averaging, we put in a little subscript of p hat to say we've averaged sample proportions. Standard deviation, same idea. We have all of those sample proportions, all of those p hat values, and this is just the standard deviation of the sample proportions. And for a symbol, we use sigma and p hat for a little subscript there. So that's our notation for mean and standard deviation here, and that's going to be important when we're making our bell-shaped curve, because eventually what we want to be doing is making this distribution that's bell-shaped, and then for the center of the distribution we want to use that mean, and we want to use that standard deviation. We can already get an idea of what value is going to come out for that mean based on what we saw happen with that 0.168. Maybe if I take some more samples, yeah, I can get closer with more and more samples. It's verging on that 0.1667 in that we expect that to come out most often. So that's where our distribution is going to center. And then taking large random samples, we should get a nice bell-shaped curve out here. So with that, this 0.167 or 0.1667, this mean should be the same as our population proportion. So whenever we get this mean out, we expect it to be the same as our population proportion. For standard deviation, we have a little formula. We'll just look at that in the next video. The shape of the dot plot, when I repeated the samples many, many times, it is normally distributed. The center ends up being the same as our population proportion, which we just talked about now. And then for standard deviation, it's a little trickier here. When we look at sampling distribution of means, we can kind of compare. We don't actually start with the sampling distribution here, start with the standard deviation, so we can't see how it changes. So instead, we just rely on standard deviation as a calculation. But let's talk about sample size and how sample size is going to change things. Let's compare if we took a sample size of 10 versus a sample size of 100. So if I set up my distribution again, but put in a much smaller sample size. So now when I generate a sample, it's taking a sample of 10. And even actually, this is a perfect example. It randomly came out with zero. So it came out that it's likely to get nothing out. And you can imagine the extremes of like all ones or no ones become way more probable when you take smaller sample sizes. And as you increase sample size, those extreme outcomes are less and less likely. Let's go ahead and generate 1,000 samples. This is a very skewed distribution. And skewed around that idea that we expect 0.1667 to come out, our mean's pretty close, but the shape of the distribution's all wrong. It's that it's heavily weighting towards having those outcomes, and then we have these kind of more random outcomes more likely. So small sample size is skewed, which is not good. We don't want skewed distributions here. So let's see what happens. Well, when we took a sample size of 60 even, we don't necessarily need to do 100. When we took our sample size of 60, we saw a nice bell-shaped curve coming through. Maybe it'd been a little weird. That's just randomization. Like, this one came out with kind of a weird scenario, but overall, it's much more bell-shaped than that sample size of 10. So, you know, if we did bump it up to 100, those weird scenarios are a lot less likely to occur. Yeah, very bell-shaped there. So, when we have larger sample sizes, it's normally distributed, which is exactly what we want. So what this is going to show is that when we use these distributions, there's going to be a sample size condition. That sample size condition that we'll talk about, you want to take your sample size times your proportion, and that should be more than or equal to 10, and sample size times 1 minus that proportion, and that should be also more than or equal to 10. That will show that we have a large enough sample size, showing 10 successes and at least 10 failures for when we run these simulations. So if we work with that sample size of 10, if we take 10 times 0.1667, which is 1.667, that's too small. So that would show that we don't have a large enough sample size. Whereas if I work with sample size of 60 and I take a sixth of it, that'll be 10, and then 60 times the opposite of that, so 1 minus the 0.1667, there would be 50, and both of those are more than or equal to 10. And with this one, we just barely pass it, with that 60 times 0.1667 being exactly 10, but it's good enough. And then if we have even larger sample sizes, even better. Like when we saw with 100, it was a lot more bell-shaped than at 60, but at 60, we still had something that was normally distributed. What in general happens to the sample proportions as the sample size gets larger? So we could do, even comparing 60 as a sample size to 100, what we want to do here is compare a number line. So like for here, we're going from about like 0.05 up to 0.3. So it's covering this distance. It's bell-shaped, it's around 0.167, that's all great. Let's see what happens when I change it to 100. What happens to our number line? Now I'm going from 0.075 up to 0.275. So there's my 0.3, 0.05 that we can't even see anymore. Essentially what happens is our number line shrunk in around our expected value. It's because if you up your sample size, that proportion's more likely to come through. So in general, when we take larger sample sizes, our sample proportions are closer to our population proportion. It's going to be more fine-tuned around that number because it's more likely to come through. Which means if our numbers are closer together, if they're closer to that expected, then what's happening to our standard deviation is it's decreasing. Because essentially it's creating less variability in the outcomes. There's this rule called the law of large numbers, that the more you repeat a process, the more likely the expected value is coming out. So the more we roll a die, the more likely we build this 1/6 probability and see it come out. So that's why as we increase these sample sizes, we get closer to what's expected, and those sample values should behave more like the population. So this is how we're gonna see our sampling distribution of proportions, how we can see the bell-shaped curve coming out. What we're going to have is the sample size condition that we need to pass just to make sure that it is indeed bell-shaped and not skewed in any way so we can calculate our probabilities.